You are listening to Radio Cosmos.
All night long.
Bravo!
My compliments, little lady.
Come on, shop. Come on, shop.
Break for 30 seconds.
Come on, shop.
End of transmission.
You are now listening to Bad Radio.
Hello and welcome to Bad Radio. Bad stands for Business at a Distance. This is a show about local businesses and business networking. We are here in the News Radio WFLA studios from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. I am your host, Angela Smarito. And to my left, we have Melissa Jacob with Striking Brand.
Hello, hello.
She is our co-host and our videographer. So if you go to badradio.com, and that's BAADradio.com, you can see all the previous episodes of the show. And if you go to strikingbrand.com, you can see all of Melissa's other work because she is a videographer as well as a photographer. And so I'm very excited to introduce Chef Alex with Alex's Fresh Kitchen to the studio.
Yay.
This is our applause here. So I met Alex a couple years ago through the networking circles. Did you hear of Alex's Fresh Kitchen through that?
Yeah, brand new.
You are in business at a distance, and you are still in business at a distance, whether you know it or not. And so we had a couple networking events there, and my husband has been following your page, and he talks about it all the time. And so that's why I called you, or I reached out to you to invite you on the show. So welcome for being here. And right now I want to talk about the networking news, and it is brought to you by Symphonic CBD, which is a branch of Live Your Best Life, and they are both advocates for Green Compass Global. Green Compass products are USDA, organic, lab-tested, non-GMO, made in the USA, and cruelty-free CBD products, and they are key to making calmness a habit. They also have CBD for our fur babies. To get more information on the benefits of CBD, visit symphonic-cbd.com. That's symphonic-cbd.com. All right. So what I wanted to talk today about in the networking news is talk about the importance of organic social media. And the reason I want to talk about that is because Chef Alex is here with us today. So how many people do you have on just your Facebook page alone?
Pretty close to 5,000.
Right. And then what are the other social media platforms that you are on?
Instagram. Mm-hmm. Instagram, I got, I think, 7,400 and counting.
Right. And you've done that all organically.
Yes.
That's amazing. So tell us how you did that, because I work with a lot of people that don't really understand how important that organic reach is.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of trial and error, number one. I had no clue anything about social media.
When I started the business,
My wife and my mom were like, oh, you need to start a social media for the business. And I'm like, okay. So I didn't know too much about what to do, just watching some YouTube videos and stuff like that. But that only gives you so much information. So when I mean like trial and error, I just kept posting. And mm-hmm. I kept posting different times of the day, 2-3 different times a day. And then hashtags. I feel like hashtags are very important depending on what you're trying to describe in your video or in your picture.
Now, are you saying hashtags for Instagram or for Facebook?
Both, because I use them for both.
Do you see? Mm-hmm. I see it more, you know, important on Instagram than I do Facebook, but I could be totally wrong there.
Probably, but yeah, I would use them for both either mm-hmm. way.
Yeah, because they both hit different demographic mm-hmm. people. So it depends on what hashtag you put. So what I started doing, I started like reading up on hashtags and what they actually do. So when I put a picture out and I put the Mamba Burger, I will put like the toppings that are on the burger and then say like very best burger or burgers.
Those are your hashtags.
Those are like.
So talk me through what the post would look like. And what are you calling it, a Mamba Burger?
Yeah, the Mamba Burger.
What's in a Mamba Burger?
Fried pickles, fried jalapenos, garlic aioli, smoked Gouda, and smoked cheddar. It's a tribute burger for the late Kobe Bryant that passed away.
Oh, okay. Mm. All right. And so you'll do the hashtags for the different things that are in that burger.
Yes. And then I'll hashtag Mamba. I'll hashtag Castleberry, Orlando Weekly. Maybe like some foodie hashtags like foodies for food. Or.
So how does hashtags bring you traffic?
Well, I think a lot of it, how it works is that when someone, like, I don't want to categorize anybody, because there's like some people that just pick up a phone, and then there's some people that go straight to the internet, your Instagram, and look up places like hashtag burgers, hashtag best burgers, hashtag Orlando's best burgers.
Or when people are searching something.
Exactly.
Do you look up like trending hashtags too to make, yes. Mm-hmm. Smart.
But some of them don't make sense with my video. Like right now it's a trending stuff is what's going on in the world, like the war and stuff. I don't want to use that to bring algorithm to my stuff. So when I do it naturally, I just keep doing what I've been doing. I post 2-3 times a day. I make sure my stories always constantly has something going, so I don't ever miss.
So you do 2-3 posts on your social media a day.
Yeah, and then reels too.
Do you schedule those out?
No.
You do those?
We were talking about that before the show.
Because I've heard also, like, if you actually do it versus, like, if you're scheduling them out, you get more views or, like, it knows.
It's just more organic because you're not scheduling to do something over and over. It's, I think, the old system before the AI system started coming out. I think when the AI system came out, they got rid of all that. So it's a whole different algorithm.
What do you mean?
I think that what he's trying to say is that it actually knows when it's a bot that's doing it,
yes.
And it knows when it's not, and then
actually posting.
Mm-hmm.
It.
Correct.
Oh, okay.
And also when you're writing something, like I can put stuff in ChatGPT and, you know, crank out content all day long, but I can read content and tell you right now if it's been generated in chat or
you
not.
You can have an AI chat on Instagram, with an AI. Like,
You can use it. Oh,
yeah,
I didn't
you
know
can
that.
Literally have a conversation with AI, and I'm just like, I don't want to do that.
You know, so funny
because
when
it's just learning you.
When I use AI, I'll say please and thank you. Is that so weird?
Yeah,
I think it's weird. I think it's a weird
but,
thing.
It seems rude not to. But it's not
it's
real.
Taking over, Angela. Don't thank it.
It definitely is because we can talk about all this right now, and then we can go check our phones later, and it's probably going to have something in our search bar.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it's listening.
Well, the reason I do that is when like AI takes over the world, they're going to remember that I was nice.
I don't think, remember, robots, bots don't have feelings.
I don't think that's how it works.
You know,
unless
I'm
you end up with an iRobot
right now.
Something that has actual feeling. I doubt it.
Oh, well, you never know. Terminator, right? Terminator.
They're going to be like, this one's vulnerable.
No, they're going to be like, this one was actually polite to us. So I'm going to cut her some slack. Anyway, so for the organic stuff, I was very impressed with because, like you said, we talked about the size of your location, and it literally is probably, I would say, 1,000 square feet?
Yeah.
You're
like right on it.
Mm-hmm. And so you walk in, and you've got some tables and stuff like
six
that.
Tables.
Do you guys primarily do to-go orders?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So people go to that. For a restaurant that size to have over 5,000 people following you on just your Facebook page is very impressive. And so I was like, okay, let me look more into it. And then I saw the videos and I'm like, dang, all right. He knows what he's doing. So do you have somebody that comes and does that for you?
Sort of. So he's helped me.
Mm-hmm.
Is
he one of your workers?
No. Okay. He is actually a person that just came in there to eat. And he would eat all the time there at the restaurant. And he was like, I've had another person helping me, and then he got into other things, you know, it happens, and we parted ways. And then I was just doing it on my own, so I was, like, smoking brisket at the house, and I was like, why don't I just record this? So I just started recording it, and I just tried different things, like cutting, you know, trying to edit it. I don't know nothing about that stuff,
right.
But I learned, you know, and then putting the music into it, and then trying to put graphics into it, and, like, make it pop. And then I started syncing music to it so that it goes with the beat and everything like that.
See, I don't do all that. I just have her do it for me because I can't figure all that out.
There's apps that can do it. I use just Instagram. I just go straight to post a new reel, and then I go to it, and I just try to my best.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't work, I won't post it, but I try my best so then I can make a post because then I'll be doing it for hours.
Mm-hmm.
But now I got a guy that's been eating at the restaurant, and he's been helping me. But we do maybe about 1 or 2 videos a month.
Like full videos? Are you just talking about reels?
Reels, videos.
Mm-hmm.
We do like 2 or 3 videos, and then he cuts them up, and then he'll just share them with me, and then I'll just post it.
Right. And so do you see with the reels that you get more activity, viewership?
I get about like 7K to 10,000 views.
Nice. That's
pretty
really
consistent.
But that's really, like I said, that's very fantastic for a restaurant your size and like one location. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's like restaurants that are looking to get that kind of activity on their social media platform.
Well, I really didn't realize I was doing that well.
Yeah.
To be honest, I always just thought we were like right below the average point. Because I look at other people's stuff, but I don't know how long they've been doing it.
Right.
So I don't know how long they've been doing this like, social media stuff. So I've only been doing it for 4 years.
Right. Well, you're doing a really good job.
Thank you.
And on that note, we are going to go to break, and when we get back, we are going to talk more with Chef Alex with Alex Kitchen. So stay tuned.
Welcome back to Bad Radio, brought to you by Premier Couple Superstore, because a couple that plays together stays together.
Welcome back, and this portion of Bad Radio is brought to you by Premier Couple Superstore. Hey guys, it's time to head over to Premier Couple Superstore and surprise your sweetheart with that sexy bedroom outfit. Premier Couple Superstore has got a huge selection of lingerie, shoes, toys, games, love oils, and a ton of great gifts. With Premier Couple Superstore, you don't pay those high prices because you go directly to the source. 5009 South OBT or shop online at premiercouples.net, because a couple that plays together stays together. So we're here today with Chef Alex with Alex's Fresh Kitchen. It's in Castleberry. And so the first section of the show, we talked about a lot of his organic stuff, organic social media, which I find great because I love the fact that you just played with it and then you figured it out and you kind of figured out what worked. And then you like met somebody who walked into the store or the restaurant and eats. And now you have like these really powerful social media platforms, and it's exciting.
And it's fun content too.
Yeah.
People are sharing food, like yummy food. I'm like, yes, all day long.
Oh, it's the stuff that he posts, like the videos and like the food and everything. I'm just like, whoa. I mean, honestly, it looks like it's like a 5-star restaurant.
Thank you.
You got to get closer.
Thank you. We definitely are a 5-star restaurant. I mean, we hold a good review, so I would say that we are. Right. I like to say that we are. I mean, we're just a little
fine dining
gem in the wall. Mm-hmm. You know, I like they say hole in the wall, but I like to say gem.
Yeah.
Do you ever consider getting a bigger place?
Yes, every day.
All right.
It's just,
what's that look like?
It's been a challenge. Mm-hmm. Just the rent is really high right now.
Just everywhere, not just everywhere.
Everywhere. Mm-hmm. And to find like a second gen type of restaurant that's already going to have everything, because I own everything in the restaurant. Mm. The problem that I'm going to have is finding a place that has a ventilation.
Mm-hmm. That's a big deal, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
because it's expensive to put that in.
It's like $25,000 just to get the materials, and that's not even paying someone to do it.
Right, right.
Well, let's back up a little bit and tell me how you got started.
Whoa.
So you said you opened it 4 years ago.
Yes, with my mom.
Okay.
Yes, my mom and I started this business back in June 1st, 2019.
Okay.
Pre-COVID. I didn't know what I was getting into. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to open a restaurant, but I didn't have an idea what we wanted to do. So everything just kind of came on the wing. You know, just I have both my mom, Lori, and my mom, Deb. So just sitting down, talking about thinking of a name, you know, was hard. Mm-hmm. I don't really remember how we even came up with Alex's Fresh Kitchen. We were going to call it Are You Kitchen Me? Mm-hmm. And then I wanted to do a food truck, but the food truck, you need to have a commissary kitchen. You got to have like your hours and everything recorded. And
did
everything.
You work in a kitchen prior, though?
Yes. Okay. Yes. I've been a chef for at least, I don't know, 20 some plus years.
You don't look that old.
I'm 38.
Yeah,
I'm 38. I started cooking with my father in 1997.
Okay.
So I've been working in Italian kitchens for, I don't know, 1997 to 2004. Then I went independent. Not independent, I went corporate. So I started working for Darden.
Okay.
I worked pretty much all their concepts that they have. I did that for about 8 to 10 years. Mm-hmm. And then I moved out to Texas. And in Texas, I did more like independent corporations. Mm-hmm. I worked for Papa Do's Seafood Kitchen.
Nice.
So they have a bunch of concepts. They have a steak. Mm-hmm. They have a cantina.
So they're like a Darden restaurant in Texas, like is here.
Yeah, but they do everything scratch.
Okay.
It's a scratch kitchen. Like it's a huge, huge process in what they do, but is by far probably the best like corporate restaurant I ever worked for.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Yes.
So that's in Texas. Are you from here originally?
I'm from Bethlehem, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Born and raised. So I kind of just traveled all over the place.
It sounds like it.
Just trying to like find myself as a chef, because at first I didn't know I was going to be a chef. I was just a cook. So I was just trying to get the next best position, you know, work my way up to sous chef, I didn't even know what a sous chef was,
right?
But I wanted that position. So when I got to Texas,
sometimes I think the sous chef does more than the actual chef. Mm-hmm. From like my point of view, I've seen I'm like the sous chef did that, the sous chef did that, and then the sous chef, and then the chef is the one that got all the recognition.
They do all the grunt work.
Mm-hmm. Oh well,
you know, all the ordering, all the scheduling. But then you know, now that I'm in this position, like I understand more why that is, and I'm gonna tell you why. Because.
Okay. Because if you don't, I'm going
to
ask you.
So growing up in the kitchen and working my way up and getting to a sous chef position, I'm like, dang, I got to do all this work and work 55 plus hours, right? But the executive chef job or the owner or manager per se, they have such a much bigger job than just cooking. It's very, very small fraction.
Mm-hmm. Of the?
Yeah, of the whole.
Well, isn't the chef like the image of the restaurant?
I mean, if... Yeah, no.
Okay.
Because there are people that are owners that are like more of the face of the place than the chef.
Mm.
And they just chef just
well,
has
then what else does the chef do if they're not taking care of all that stuff?
Well, you got all the admin stuff. So they're more like an accountant in a way.
Ugh.
Yes.
That's no fun.
It's not fun because you have to look at every number, you know, how much money you're bringing in, how much revenue, how much loss,
food costs,
labor costs, all that. Plays an effect. You lose all the creativity and being a chef.
Mm-hmm.
Like you're not cooking.
That makes me sad.
But that's like every business owner, right? Yeah. If you're a business owner, you're not doing the craft. Yeah. You're usually more the administration.
That's like sad though. So, but I mean, is that what you're doing now? Because in those videos, it looks like you're like on the line.
Excuse me. No.
I forgot the question already.
I'm like 50-50. I push myself a lot. Like I try to be on the line with the guys a lot, but I find myself in the front.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm more at the register talking to customers.
Customer
and
service.
Stuff. Yeah, right. Because it's got to be a balance.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're chefs, and I don't want them being in the front being the customer service.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been a battle, and that's another reason why I've been trying to find a bigger place so that way we can do more of a like – not fine dining, but more of like an elevated dining. So someone comes to you and talks to you, brings you your drinks and stuff like that. Like we're already grown to the point where we need to be like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, if I remember, you can see the kitchen from the back.
Yeah.
So it would be considered an open kitchen, right?
100%.
Yeah. I used to work at a seafood restaurant at Church Street Station called Crackers. And at the front of the house and the back of the house were the same room. It was just one bar.
Wow.
So that like, separated it so you could watch all the cooks do everything. And
I love that.
Yeah, it was very cool, except for the lobster tank, because I would cry every time a lobster got sold.
Oh, no.
And yeah, I did. The one chef told me one time, because they didn't put it in hot water, they had like a steamer. They would open up the door and throw the lobster in there.
Man. Hold? They didn't kill it?
No, it was alive.
Oh.
Is it? I thought it was horrible, but he said count to 10. Once you get to 10, it's over.
Oh.
And then,
okay.
And so I was helpful. Just like, I mean, it was hard.
Yeah, we always just kill them. Like,
do you have lobster?
If I did it at the restaurant, yes, it would be whole and like, I would do it. We've done it a few times like pre-COVID. Well, after mid-COVID, I would say we were doing dinners.
Yeah.
So we started doing a lot of dinner specials and we were doing everything that we can think of to bring people in because I had just started the business and it was about to close.
Yeah,
because of COVID.
Because of COVID. God, I have so many questions from there. I like, how did you make it through COVID? You know what I mean? Like, so I'm not even sure where to get
started.
Well,
that open kitchen thing, like, that's really cool as a customer. Like, do you do that? Was that intentional? Is there a benefit or negative?
Yes.
Or?
That was intentional because of Alex's Fresh Kitchen. I wanted people to see the real concept of Fresh Kitchen because you got Fresh Kitchen down the street that claims that they're fresh, but what is fresh that they're doing?
Yeah. I mean, their lettuce might be fresh and that's the max of it.
Stuff so that sits there for 2-3 hours
right.
Before they have to throw it away and it sits in little pretty bowls to keep it hot. Come on, man. That is not fresh.
Well, we're getting ready to come up to a break right now. And when we get back, we're going to talk more with Alex Fresh Kitchen. So stay tuned for more Bad Radio.
Welcome back to Bad Radio, brought to you by Premier Couple Superstore. Because a couple that plays together stays together.
And welcome back. This portion of Bad Radio is brought to you by Forge IT Consulting, providing a fully outsourced IT department with a personal touch for small business. No company is too small. ForgeITConsulting.com. And so we're here today with Chef Alex with Alex's Fresh Kitchen. And oh man, we're kind of jumping all over the place, but all of it is just fascinating mm-hmm. because it really is what you would say is a successful small restaurant, mm-hmm. which there's so, it's so hard for them to make it past that 2 year mark.
Right, right.
So, but you didn't just make it past the 2 year mark. You made it past the 2 year mark during COVID. Yeah. So how did, I mean, how, first of all, let's just talk about what, where were you at in your business when COVID hit?
We were booming.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because when it was just me and my mom. Mm-hmm. My mom did gluten-free desserts. I had like 7 things on the menu. I was more partaking to Crunch mm-hmm. and more health fitness.
Okay.
That's Alex Fresh Kitchen.
Crunch is right across the street from where his restaurant is.
Oh, okay.
So I was doing like granola plates, oatmeal, parfaits. Mm-hmm. So something more light and mm-hmm. healthier than what we're doing now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we were just doing so good. I didn't expect it for the area that we were in, and we were growing, but growing slowly. And then when COVID came, nobody wanted that food.
Mm. The health food?
No. Nobody wanted that. People were coming. That's how the Mama Burger started, because when the COVID thing was starting to happen, Kobe Bryant had passed away.
Right.
And everyone kept coming to the restaurant talking about Kobe Bryant. I didn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
And then they were asking for burgers and pizza. I was like, my mom's like, we're not, mm-hmm. we don't do that. So my mom was like,
you got to make something.
You got to make a burger, but she used a different word for that I can't say.
Mm-hmm.
So she was, make that burger, Alex. And I was like, all right, mama. And we used to close 7 a.m. to 3. So we opened at 7 a.m., but we were closed at 3. So
right.
I was going home. It was already the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
I went home. I ended up seeing it was true about Kobe passing away. And I just felt so driven. You know, I watched them play, but besides playing, like, off the court was the most important for me as far as what I followed him for.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just like, I'm going to create this burger in a tribute to him. And when I did that, it just brought a lot of people to us.
Mm-hmm.
So then I was like, you know, freak it. I'm just going to make burgers. So then we just started doing a specials board. And then that's the chalkboard that we have in the restaurant. And we're very cultured in the kitchen, in the Haitian, Puerto Rican, and Italian. So we all clash and like, what we're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so I let them all create something. And that's kind of like how the dinner started.
That's super fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What are your hours right now?
Right now we are, it's kind of all over the place. So Monday and Tuesday we're closed. Wednesday, Thursday, 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. Mm-hmm. Friday and Saturday, 10 a.m. to 3. We close at 3. We reopen at 5 from 5 to 10.
So I just kind of assume that a lot of your regulars like have that memorized so they know.
No?
No.
Not at
okay,
all.
Okay, maybe not.
They're still pulling on that door. Mm-hmm. What's going on? Like, I'm like, so, 5 o'clock.
So with the mix of people, so your menu, is it like kind of eclectic because of that mix of your backgrounds?
Yes.
And you let them all kind of, everybody kind of works together. And how do you determine like what? Okay,
I know. This is, to flip a coin?
This is good enough to like stay on the menu. Like how do you?
We all have enough respect for like each other that there's just no, there's no ego clashing.
Yeah.
That's
and,
very cool.
And when there is, I like.
Stop it.
Stop that.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. we're all the same. We all refer each other as chefs. We all. You know, we all respect each other, like, as far as, like, in the kitchen and outside of the kitchen, too. I mean, we're there with each other all day,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
neck to neck. So we have to learn to be like family. And mm-hmm. if you can't, then you can't work there.
Have you had the same employees for
yes.
that whole time? See, that's really mm-hmm. important.
Yep.
So there's a lot of things that I'm starting to understand more and more why you did make it as far, you know, to this point. So you changed your menu items to accommodate what people were asking for, and then that just sort of like...
Yeah, because we were at, what, 50%, 25% capacity?
Oh, yeah.
And I only have 6 tables and 6 feet distance. It just didn't make sense to have people in my restaurant and then people complain
mm-hmm.
and then write bad views about me because my tables are not separated. It was very chaotic.
Mm-hmm.
You do the whole thing putting people outside, too? Did you have room outside?
No.
No.
I was a very against everything. Like I was like going back and forth with both my mothers, sure. and they wanted me to close
all together.
Mm-hmm. And I was just like, "This is my dream. Like mm-hmm. I'm not throwing this away.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm gonna be here every day I was like, the president is going to have to come in here and tell me to close the restaurant.
Good for you. Mm-hmm. I applaud that.
I just stayed. I stayed. And, you know, it brings some friction in the family because, you know, my mom wanted me to get the shot. I was like, I don't believe in this. Yeah. I'm not getting the shot. I'm not wearing a mask. I'm like, how are you going to wear a mask in 95 degree weather outside in the kitchen?
In the kitchen.
It's it's like double degrees. So it's like 97, 98 in the kitchen.
Wow. I didn't think about that.
And then you're wearing a mask.
Yeah, I saw people wearing it in their car.
And then you're sweating. Yeah. And then you're going to, give you a plate of food. Hey, here you go. Welcome to Alex's fresh, sweaty kitchen. Like,
gross.
Like, come on.
Yeah. That was a hard time, too. I have a friend who has a diner. It has like a brunch diner. So that's what, like, when you're talking about putting the vent system in, like, things like that, he was saying the same sort of thing. So during COVID, it was really hard for him. I don't know if he had the same thing, trying to make sure that he could pay his employees, his staff, when you're already working off of like quarter capacity. Yeah. So that was that like
that was challenge? That was definitely a challenge. That's why we had to come up with dinners to go. So what I found out was that later on at night between 5 and like 9 o'clock, people were out looking for food. People got tired of being in the house all damn day. So I was only open from 7 to 3. Like, we changed our hours like 3 or 4 times.
Right.
Just to like try to find a niche of where we fit in. And
no, that makes sense. I mean, you got to figure out what works. I mean, not just for the customers, but for you too. I heard you say you have Monday, Tuesday closed, right? And I mean, there's a lot of chain restaurants that wouldn't even dream of closing for 2 days, regardless of the mental health of their staff.
I would like to be open, but I think about my guys. Like, they mean a lot to me. They're like my brothers.
People need a day off.
You need time to recuperate. You need time for yourself. You're like in this station all day long, you know, flipping this, doing this all the time, you know, bickering back and forth with each other. You know, it gets tiring over time. Yeah. So you need time to digress. You need time
that you're still successful with the same employees because you have that mentality. That it's like, you know, there's something that are more important than the almighty dollar. And that's really what happens is a lot of these
quality of life.
Is that they will like give up all of that stuff, their employees' mental health or physical well-being, all that stuff. You know, to make sure that they're open at 7 o'clock in the morning for like the one customer that comes in and orders one thing. And it doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever. And I know people curse Chick-fil-A for closing on Sundays, but I'm like, good for them. You know, people need a day off.
I'm glad they do that because there's not, like you said, there's not many corporates that do that.
Not at all.
They're more about that bang. They're more about the buck. They're more about where that goes up and down.
The almighty dollar is what
that's why I left corporations.
Yeah.
Like, I've worked all the way up to the top, and I was about to have my own store in Arizona. They were going to move me out there for Darden. And I was like, no, this is not what I want. I don't want to be a manager store.
But you know how many people don't make that change? Her and I have both been in that situation where we worked for, I actually worked for this company right here. And I was like 42 years old. I looked at my husband and I said, all right, I'm going to become a career salesperson here, but this is what you're going to get. Look at me. I mean, making, you know, really good money, but as like 30 pounds heavier, I was drinking every single day. I was mentally, like, I would have anxiety attacks. And not because of, it's just the sales, like, what's the right word for it? The environment in itself. And it's not just iHeart, it's Cox Media, it's Odyssey, it's all of those places. You know what I mean? When you become a career, you you sacrifice a lot of yourself to do that. And for you, same story, right?
Yeah, same story. The owner was just all about the money, So he didn't really care too much about his employees. I worked for the same company with the original owner and worked there for 7 years and loved it. I would do anything for that company. They changed ownership. Within 2 years, I was gone. Because I was like, the first year, it's like, okay, this transition, you know. By the second year, you're like, oh, this isn't going to change.
You see all the BS.
That's
for any corporation.
But then launching your own is just as scary as could be as well.
I wanted it too much.
I think
I've had numerous conversations with my mothers at dinner tables, you know, like just because I have helped a lot of restaurants like open here in Orlando. So I've been part of that team to help open. So I've always sent pictures to my mom. Hey, mom, check it out. Check out this dish. This is the new restaurant they're opening. Stuff like that. And I knew she was always proud. And I always ask her, when are you going to invest? When are you going to invest in your son, like open a restaurant? She's like, always say, you need more seasoning. You need more seasoning. I said, I've been a chef for it.
Mm-hmm. I know.
This damn
I'm
long,
not going to get any spicier than I am right now.
How much more seasoning am I going to need? So my last restaurant that I helped open was in Edgewater. It was called Cafe Linger. It's not there no more. I was just done.
I want to hear more about this, but you know what that means? Yes. That means we're going to break. And so when we get back, we are going to talk more with Chef Alex with Alex's Kitchen. So stay tuned for more Bad Radio.
Welcome back to Bad Radio, brought to you by Premier Couple Superstore, because a couple that plays together stays together.
Welcome back, and this portion of Bad Radio is brought to you by Ground Up Property Services. With the changing of seasons, now is a good time to get your irrigation system serviced, so call Ground Up Property Service today. And it's also a good idea to ask Rick Hall with Ground Up Property Services about a water sensor, so your lawn does not get too much water. And don't forget about the lawn painting service. If you're planning an outdoor event and you want to hide those brown spots on the lawn, call 407-468-4295. All right, so we're finishing up talking with Chef Alex with Alex's Fresh Kitchen. So this is the last segment. So I want to talk about the food now. So I mean, we talked about like the startup and all the other stuff. But okay, so let's talk about the food. Now, you said it's Alex's Fresh Kitchen because that's what it is. So every day, new food comes in.
He wants to be honest.
Yes, I'll be very honest. Mm-hmm. I order every week, okay. But it depends on business.
Right, right.
So, like, since the TV show came out, we have been a lot busier than what.
So
we
tell
expect.
Us about the TV show.
Yeah, what TV show?
It's called Blind Kitchen.
Okay,
okay.
It's on very local app. You can download it and watch it on Vizio.
Well, I saw Apple. Some of the reels on your social media. So.
Yeah. So you just got to download it. It's a free app. You can pretty much stream it on any platform. A little bit about the show is I'm blindfolded, and I'm going to be tasting another chef's creation.
Right.
And I have a certain amount of time to touch, smell, and feel it. And then I have to recreate that dish.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
So did you make the show, or is this show somebody that came out?
Someone came out and reached out to me. So like it's an actual show, yes. So it's an actual show started, I believe, in Boston, made it out to Louisiana, and now they're in Orlando. Mm-hmm. So it's eight episodes of local chefs, local upcoming chefs, or local chefs that have been around, that have a name, and then they're battling against each other.
Mm-hmm. All right. So they reached out to you, and they so I'm very curious. So when this started, so are all of them on
Very Local App?
Yeah, yes. Right now?
Right now. You can watch it right now.
Okay.
I'm episode 2.
Okay. And yeah. So how did you do?
You had to watch it.
Oh.
You have to watch
right,
it.
That was the right answer.
Right. I was going to say. What?
Yeah.
Well, no, I want to watch it. Like I said, I saw all the reels and everything on there, and I was very curious
was
what
very
that
fun.
Was.
It was a very, very cool experience. It was very unexpected, and they reached out, and I was just like, I've been trying to get on the show for a while. I've been interviewed for quite a few, but just never actually made it to the end. So when they offered me, I was like, yeah, I'm definitely going to do it.
Heck yeah. So every day, do you do a brand new menu?
No, it's the same menu. Every week we change the special board, but we prep every day. Everything in the kitchen is fresh. Like, we make all our aiolis. We make all our vinaigrettes.
It's a scratch kitchen?
Yeah, it's a scratch kitchen. Mm-hmm. Like, we don't have anything frozen. Mm-hmm. Like, if anything's frozen, it's because we froze it.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
And
yeah.
The only thing that would be frozen would be the vegan burgers. Because we just don't sell that much, but we make a lot, and then we freeze them, and then we cook them from frozen. But it's a real burger. It's not like Impossible or Beyond Burger.
Right.
You know, we're making out of lentils, gluten-free flour, flaxseed.
Oh, wow.
Mushrooms.
I have to tell my sister. My sister is like a hardcore vegan.
Vegan?
Yeah.
Yeah. We get them in there. They get excited because they think that we have like a bunch of options, but
no.
We only have two. We have a vegan pancake and we have
a
burger.
Well, that's two more than a lot of places that's offer. True. So there you go.
And it's true vegan. Like everything on the bun, the product, everything is vegan. It's, like I said, it's not soy. It's not GMO. Stuff. I don't use any of that stuff.
That's really cool. And do people call ahead of time and ask about the specials? I'm just curious how you interact with your guests.
Oh, yeah. They definitely do. especially the regulars. Hey, Alex, what specials you have this week? Mm-hmm. And then I'll go to the board. Mm-hmm. I'll go to the board and I'll look and I'm like, explain to them what it is. And sometimes I post, but it's a lot to like remember.
Right.
And like, oh, I got to post this today.
Oh, yeah.
And do the specials and stuff. But for people that follow us, they know what to do. Right. They know they have to call because it's not going to be on the website. It's not going to be always on Instagram. It's more of a phone call.
Give us some examples of some specials. I mean, do you like do like home, like they said, shepherd's pie or that sort of thing? Or is it?
We haven't done shepherd's pie yet. It's been in conversations quite a few times. The thing is that I don't like to do anything that's already been done.
Mm-hmm. I like so everything's original?
Not like, I would say original because we've created it, like recreated the wheel. Like, for example, like a Cuban, right?
Uh-huh.
Like Cuban mm-hmm. comes with the pork, the ham, the cheese.
Mm-hmm.
I created the Rican. So I'm Puerto Rican.
Mm-hmm.
So basically what I do is I cook a pork, which is called pernil. We cook that down, which is a roasted pork. Put that on there, and I use a fried cheese, which is queso fiel.
Mm-hmm.
Put that on there, and then I put avocado, sweet plantain, or fried plantain.
Oh, that sounds good.
And then I use carved ham instead of like that deli ham.
Mm-hmm.
So you get like you're actually eating out of like a pit ham.
Right, right.
Right. And then I get pan sobao, which is a sweet bread, Puerto Rican bread. And I use pretty much the same process as a Cuban bread
mm-hmm.
and a Cuban sandwich. I do it the same way. Mm-hmm. And we made that up. Like, you don't find that anywhere.
Mm-hmm. I remember when Zach was in here, Zach Bastian with Crazy Muscle Nutrition, and he started to tell us everything that was in, what did you call his burger?
Dragon Burger.
The Dragon
Burger.
Yeah. Do you know? Can you
I'm not
up?
The creator of that one.
Okay.
Chef Pablo uh-huh. is the creator of that one. Like, Zach asked me to do it, but I've been so busy. And at uh-huh. that time, I was doing the show and the recording. So I told Pablo just to work on this mm-hmm. for him.
Mm-hmm.
And so he kind of just took the wheel and just did it. So it's really Pablo's creation.
Yeah, because yeah. Dragon Labs is what mm-hmm. he calls mm-hmm. like the thing that makes the chill pills and
yeah.
right, everything like that. So... We know Zach. I've known Zach since he was a little guy.
Oh, okay.
Little tyke.
Yeah, little tyke. And so when we got reacquainted, when he was older, I was so impressed with him because with the nutrition store,
mm-hmm.
and this was when it was over in Longwood.
Yeah.
And so when we moved to Castleberry, I remember when he told me that, I was like, that's where Alex's Fresh Kitchen is. He's mm-hmm. like, yeah, that is. They even got a burger.
I got a burger. So how do you pick your specials? Like, is it just like...
It's random.
Yeah. And everybody, I'm assuming, works together
yeah.
and like does their own thing.
Like right now we're working on curry rice, ground lamb, olive tapenade,
jeez.
And some other stuff. We're doing it in a wrap.
Uh-huh.
And I were like thinking about it since yesterday. Like I got this ground lamb. I'm like, okay, what are we going to do with it? He's like, I don't know, chef. And I'm just like, all right, well, let's do this.
Where do you go to get inspired?
My crazy brain. I've worked for so many chefs
mm-hmm.
From like Philly to New York, New Jersey, Delaware, Connecticut, North Carolina, South mm-hmm. Carolina, Louisiana, Texas. It's just been all over. So
yeah.
I've worked under so many different chefs, so many different cultures. I've learned so much.
You pick from other places.
Yeah, I just learned anything that I learned that I didn't know already. And I was like, oh, wow. And I learned how to cut like this now. I learned how to season this. And
I have two more questions real quick before I forget.
No, go ahead.
Because I'm going to forget them. Do any of the specials, do you ever put them on like your regular menu?
Yes. So the fan favorites that are on the menu now are mm-hmm. a lot of old specials like when we first started in 2020, 2019.
Which are like what?
Carolina Reaper.
All right, that's obviously hot.
Allison's Choice.
That's what's out there.
Yeah.
All right, tell everybody what that is.
Oh, so that's braised. Sometimes I do it smoked. Sometimes we do it braised, depending on how busy we are. So right now it's braised brisket and mac and cheese.
Mm.
And we do garlic aioli and we do white cheddar cheese on the bottom.
Do you ever just do like specials with brisket?
Yeah.
I want to come because I'm like, I love brisket so much.
Sometimes I just smoke it and I separate the lean part and the fat part and then I cut slices.
I had a brisket in St. Augustine and it was amazing, amazing. And then I had it again in Baton Rouge and I hated it. Mm. It was so fatty. Mm. Was this not good?
You're getting more of the spare rib out there.
Yeah. Is that why?
Yeah, it's different.
Okay. I looked at it. I was like, that's I don't know if I can eat that. It just, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's more of a fatty rib right at the top.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you're going to have to call me when you're going to do like the beef brisket so that we can come out.
And we do it all the time. I haven't smoked brisket in a while, but since you've asked, I'm pretty sure more people are going to ask this week.
Probably.
They're going to be like, when are you going to do the smoked brisket again? I'm like, okay.
Well, do you do stuff for the seasons, like chili when it gets cool? And
so
stuff?
Chef James, he does the cookies, and he does like a lot of the soups and stuff. So once it starts getting cold, we'll start doing the soups. There's times that we've done the soups like now, and like no one buys them because it's hot.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's what I was thinking.
But when it's nice and cool and it's getting cool outside, we sell the soup. Mm-hmm. Butternut squash soup, lobster bisque. Tomato, and I think
you got to do like a chicken noodle.
He does, he does like a chicken noodle, but it doesn't do as well as those.
Oh, does that mean we're out of time? Mm-hmm. Well, tell you what, we're going to have you on the show again. So definitely thank you so much for being here. Give everybody your contact information.
So we're at 1015 FL 436, which is State Road 436, Suite 109, Castleberry, Florida.
All right. And you can find me at Melissa at strikingbrand.com is my email, or strikingbrand.com is my website.
And I am Angela, so stay tuned for another hour of Bad Radio.